we're joined once again by geneticist Razib Khan. Mr. Khan, thank you so much for coming on the show today.
Oh, my pleasure, Nick.
To follow up on the Olmecs, we explained the Afrocentric theories that surround the subject as to who they were and whether or not there is an African origin to Olmec civilization. But to further set the record straight, I wanted to bring Mr. Khan on to talk about your favorite subject, and that is ancient DNA and how it shapes the history that we have today. And so, Mr. Khan, before we begin, would you tell the audience a little bit about yourself and what you do?
So my name is Razib Khan. I am a geneticist in my offline work. I work in the private sector in biotech and genomics and genetics, but online you can find me at my Substack, razib.substack.com, where I talk about genetics, history, other topics that where I think you and I, Nick, have a meeting of the minds. And you can find all my stuff at razib.com. I do contribute to other publications like Unheard, National Review, et cetera, you know, book reviews and whatnot.
And before we get started, check out the links in the video description below. It's going to take you to all of the awesome work that Mr. Khan is doing to better help people like me and you better understand the past that we all love. And as someone who's actually subscribed to his Substack, I honestly can't recommend it enough. From Bronze Age archaeologists like Dr. Eric Klein to the very topics that fascinate us all, including the Indo-Europeans, the history of the steppes, Mr. Khan provides a Substack that has something for everyone. And now we're going to discuss the DNA of the Olmecs.
Yeah, so I think the issue here is, part of it is, I don't think we have DNA directly from the Olmecs. What we need to do is kind of get them in the scaffold of the genomic history of the Americas, which has been established now. So there's several things we need to talk about when we talk about ancient people who don't have written records. One thing is the archaeology. Another issue is the paleontology. And so paleontology, I'm talking about skulls, skeletons, right? And then we're talking about DNA. The DNA has come along recently, but now these three things can be brought together to kind of create a scaffold of the population history. To understand Mexico, I think, you know, because we don't have a huge ancient DNA transect yet, what you need to do is get the genetic variation of Mexicans today and understand it in the context of the genetic variation of the Americas as a whole that we have. So most of your listeners know that there's a hypothesis of people in the New World coming across over the Bering Strait on the order of 15,000 to 20,000 years ago, closer to 15. But in any case, that makes some predictions in relation to the genetics, okay? So most people in the New World who have indigenous ancestry, you know, they have detectable indigenous ancestry. And so you can look in Mexico. So there's a group, Maria Avila in Mexico runs it. It was trained as a postdoc at Stanford. They've looked at all of the genetic variation of people in Mexico, and Mexicans are a mixture of three primary groups. One group is Europeans, mostly Iberians. The other group is Africans, mostly people from South or West Africa. And the last group is the indigenous people of the New World, correct? So what they found is the structure of variation of Mexicans of the indigenous ancestry is geographically differentiated. That means that if you're a Mexican from Oaxaca, or you're a Mexican from Jalisco, your indigenous ancestry is different, okay? That means that the variation of the Nahua people in the south and the Pima people in the north, all these different ethnic groups, it's maintained in modern day Mexicans because, you know, when European settlers came, mostly men, they married local women, and the local women were from that region. So what this is telling us is that you can recapitulate the genetic variation of Mexicans from their ancestors who lived there before 1492, okay? Who are those ancestors? So this is what we know. There are a fair number of ancient remains from the New World. So a lot of your listeners will know about Kennewick Man in Kennewick, Washington. There was a lot of controversy over the identity of Kennewick Man. When you looked at the skull of Kennewick Man, paleontologists, anthropologists, they thought it looked more like maybe Southeast Asian, Ainu, or even European. This caused an enormous amount of controversy at the time. Here's the issue. When you look at skulls, when you look at skeletons, those are subject to variation within populations. There are always people that are at one end of the distribution for their population. And so you don't know if they're representative. When you look at a genome, what you're doing is you're sampling a whole pedigree, their whole ancestral information. So they have gotten genetic data out of populations in the region of Kennewick Man and Kennewick Man, okay? And what they have found is those individuals are pretty much ancestral to the type of population you see in the New World that we label indigenous. And those individuals seem to be distantly related to Siberians, okay? And just for your listener and the viewer, I wanna be kind of like a little in the weeds here and detailed. So these people who arrived from Siberia are not the Siberians of today. They're a more ancient population that lived in Siberia before more recent demographic transitions and transformations of the Pleistocene and Holocene, the last 15,000 years. So about 60 to 70% of the ancestry of the people of the New World is much more closely related to, say, Han Chinese and Japanese than any other world population, East Asians. But 30 to 40% of their population is what we call Paleo-Siberian or ancient North Eurasian. And this genetic ancestry component is not particularly closely related to East Asians. It's very, very distantly related to the peoples of West Eurasia. So the Ket people of, say, Central Siberia are an example of people that have a high proportion of this ancestry. It turns out that about like 10 to 15% of the ancestry of Europeans is also Paleo-Siberian, as well as, say, a similar proportion in South Asia, in the Caucasus. So these Paleo-Siberian people had a huge impact all across the world by mixing with people to their east, Native American ancestors, and people to their west, some part European, Indo-European, whatnot. The dominant Y chromosomal lineage in the New World is Q. And that Y chromosomal lineage is the quote brother lineage to R, which is the dominant one in Europe and South Asia. And so that tells you that that's probably Paleo-Siberian men. So if I had a hypothesis, it would be Paleo-Siberian males seem to have mixed with a population with a lot of East Asian females and then eventually crossed over into Beringia, which is, you know, lost civilization now, lost territory. And what happened around 15,000 years ago was the last glacial maximum abated and they moved westward. A small population moved westward. And all Native Americans, they do seem to be descended from this ancestral population, with one exception. There are some populations in South America, particularly in Amazonia, that are distantly related to the people of the Andaman Islands and Australia. And we don't really know what's going on here. You know, geneticists are not gods. There's some things that just can't be explained yet. And this has been confirmed with ancient DNA from Brazil. Like they did find an individual with this weird, you know, like unexplained population cluster. So, there are some unexplained mysteries, but we have not detected any African-like populations in the New World, to my knowledge. And African populations are very, very genetically distinct. The separation between African populations and non-African populations occurred anywhere between 60 to 200,000 years ago, depending on the African population that you are, you know, thinking of. So for example, West Africans, the most likely donor population in the New World and the donor population to the African diaspora in the New World, diverged from Eurasians on the order of 60 to 100,000 years ago. And so they show up, when they show up in the ancient DNA, they're very clear, they're very distinct. And to my knowledge, we don't see any of this in the New World samples before 1492. There are some mysteries though in this field. We don't know everything. So, you know, we do need to keep an open mind expect to be surprised. There are arguments now about how long ago modern humans lived in the New World. And like there's a site in Mexico that might date to before 20,000 years, before the last glacial maximum. And so we don't know where those people are. There's a hypothesis that if this is correct, and there's arguments among archaeologists about this site, and I can't wade into that, that's not my field. If this is correct, we might be able to understand this mysterious third component ancestry in South America. Maybe there are people here earlier, we don't know. So there are mysteries out there, just not the mysteries that sometimes are propounded, you know, by some scholars and thinkers.
Ladies and gentlemen, thank you for joining us today at the Study of Antiquity and the Middle Ages, where we took you through what DNA can tell us, not only about the ancient Americas, but specifically Olmec civilization and some of the issues we are still facing today to solve this story. Don't forget, check out the links in the video description below. It's going to take you to all of the hard work that he is doing and really give Mr. Khan your full support. Mr. Khan, thank you so much for coming on the show today.
My pleasure, Nick.